much for the nice introduction. Now, before I say anything, I would first of all like to thank you all for being here today. So it's a late night, almost, but for dropping in and supporting us. Also, thank you very much for the industrial speakers to fly in and come to us, and also to the media that is with us today filming the entire event. Now, but most of all, I would like to thank the organizers for the not only vision of the future, how drones can be making an impact, but also the leadership and the courage to step up and make this happen. So thank you again. So please have me. So it's the first year's initiative, so it's really amazing. Okay, so today what I want to talk about is about how bioinspiration can help us to develop the next generation of drones. So if you think of drones today, we've seen some, but what will the future look like? What will we have as drones in 20, 30 years, and how can we make it? So today we have about 500,000 UAVs that are on the market. They're used for military. It started in the military about more than 100 years ago. In fact, Nikola Tesla, at the end of the 19th century, invented drones and unmanned ground vehicles and surface vehicles. But so it started with the military, but now goes very much into other areas as well, including agriculture, smart farming, media, filming, industrial inspection, and even consumers. So there's a lot of movement on hobbies, drones, that you can build your own. Now, for example, to give you a few examples of industrial applications is this. In Gatwick Airport, Airbus uses drones to inspect the surfaces of the wings of the aircrafts before taking off, because it is much cheaper, much faster than to do that manually. In fact, it also provides much more data than doing it with visual inspection. Other applications include the oil and gas industry, for example, pipeline inspection, BP, Shell, Total, all the big companies are really looking into that, but mainly focusing on the photography aspect. There's another area for geology research or environmental research, or mapping, for example, where you have this type of fixed-wing vehicles. They have a camera on them and the initial measurement unit. They can be launched very easily. They can fly to take a lot of pictures, then stick the pictures together and create a 3D map of the environment as you see here. So these type of maps are very easy to take based on only the pictures, but already this is hugely valuable. I mean, if you want to do a pipeline planning or a road planning through the environment, this is really important. And this is a huge market. In fact, this was a startup from the lab where I did my PhD in Switzerland. And now it's, I think, like 70 employees grew very fast into just doing the aerial photography and mapping. Now the question then is, what next? What in 20 years? And I think there are a few things that will happen in 20 years. First of all, what will happen is that our planet will become very much roboticized. It will become robotic, and robotics is really the big next revolution in technology. So it will be automated, it will have robotic aspects. What will also happen is that most people will move into the cities. So we will have about 3 billion people more living in cities in the next 20 years. Now to do that, what will they want? So we will want to be equipped with infrastructure, with communication, with sensing, and all this connectedness, this interconnectedness needs to be created, and drones have a very important role to play in this. So in this ecosystem of different sensors and robots that work together in harmony. So I want to talk to you about today quickly, give you an overview, is how this can be human-centric, how these technologies can be ethical and support our humans, the humans on the planet in a supportive way. So what is important, how this can help is on material flows, on information flows, and on agriculture. So where these vehicles could provide not just information, but also act on the environment and support the agricultural built environment. So if you think then of future cities, what needs to flow? And there are a lot of things that need to flow and move through the cities. For example, there is cargo. There's also other logistic systems, waste, and these materials. And in fact, if you look at that, there is about 360,000 tons of material flowing through London every day. So it's a huge mass of materials flowing through the cities. Now, what if you imagine that you would have drones delivering part of that? How would that work? In fact, instead of having these truck-based systems that we have today, where you have one big truck going from place to place to place to deliver the objects, we could have a flexible logistic system where you have a parallel approach of drones moving in parallel to go to all these different places at the same time. So like this, this offering a very much a scalable and flexible and faster approach to logistics of delivery in urban areas. So I'm sure you've seen the Amazon trials or adverts on this type of technology, and there's a huge need for that, and different companies develop that. And I think one area where it will happen the first is not so much in big developed cities, but in the developing countries where the road infrastructure is not in place yet. And in fact, there is one project that I'm involved in myself, which is the Red Line Drone Delivery Network in Africa, where we're looking at drone delivery in these rural areas, where we can improve the delivery of blood samples, vaccines, or any kind of other medication, which are time sensitive. So instead of going into the road infrastructure and building the roads, we can go directly to aerial infrastructure and build the aerial highways to make it much more effective. So the same happened in wireless technologies. Now, instead of putting all the wires in the floors, they went directly into wireless technology. So the same thing is happening now with drone delivery as well. Now, of course, the logistics needs also the intelligence, also needs the information about what needs to be developed and how this can be delivered. And there are the needs as well, not just on delivery aspects, but also on other. For example, on traffic management in urban areas and energy management to identify the heat sinks in the environment. Or, for example, emergency response, where you could have drones detecting any kind of pollution or hazardous environments after floods or tsunamis to save the people more quickly. So now, what if we would then have these drones that would do data-driven nowcasting? So instead of putting sensors everywhere and then react on the events, you could have the sensors being mobile and moving around in the environment to detect and follow the phenomena. So if there is a fire in one part of the city, the drones could move there and detect, collect the data there where it is needed. So like this, the data would not just be big and you would have too much data, you would also have relevant data which is then supplied by the drones. Now this of course is a research challenge, and the question is how do you make the movement to attach to different structures? How do you allow them to move in these complex environments? And this is one research theme that we have in my group, where we look into perching techniques for drones. So how can drones attach to structures and perch the structures to sense the environment? So here the idea is that you have a hard to access area, let's say an oil platform or a bridge or anything like that. And then you have one drone that flies and deposits a temporary support structure that then the second drone attaches to it, like this perches to the environment, and like this can observe the environment without using precious flying energy. It doesn't actually own an oil platform, but it's an animation. Okay, so the way how to do that is we analyze different animals, how they perch, and then maybe we can learn something from it. In fact, if you look at eagles, so like big birds, how they perch, they fly, they have a vision system, they pitch up, they attach to the surface. It's all very complex, very skilled, and needs a lot of computation, vision, grasping, actuation. And this can be done on larger robots, about 1 kilogram in weight or larger, that have all this computation power, the sensors on board to do that. What happens, however, is when you get to smaller sizes, for example, to insect sizes or like the size of a fly, we can look and in fact you see that some completely different happens. So a fly does not pitch up like an eagle to land on the ceiling. What it does instead is it just flies straight into the wall and just attaches to it from flight. So it's a very different strategy, a much more robust potentially strategy. And what it does is it damps its impact with the legs. So the legs actually damp the impact and act as a mechanical intelligence system that allows them to perch to the structure by using their morphology to damp the impact. So this way of mechanical intelligence helps them to actually reduce the need for complex control. So we need the complex control, but we can also complement it using mechanical intelligence structures. On the spiders as well, they use their string to attach themselves and entangle themselves in the environment, and this is what we've done in this idea of the string-based perch. So here in the laboratory you see real experiments. So this is in our flight lab where we use external camera systems and these palm-sized drones that are about this big to fly and create even weave structures like spider webs that the other drones could come and attach to a disobserved environment. They've lost the peace, huh? We'll come to that in a second. Okay, so that's one research area of how to approach, and they can use these tensile elements like spiders to support it. Okay, a completely different project is to look at ways how we can sample the environment, not just in air, if you have air pollution or a hazardous accident, for example, but also to do water sampling. Now this is very important, for example, after a flood where you want to detect the contamination of bacterial contamination close to people and save them more quickly. So for this you have developed this idea of the aquatic microwave vehicles, which would fly to a disaster zone, fold the wings, then dive into the water, take underwater video footage or a sample and then fly out and return to the base station. That is being able to move not just in air but also move underwater. Now to do that, of course, it's very hard. You have to build morphing wings, you have to build low drag surfaces, sensors that can allow you to morph them in the right time, and also to transition back to flight. It's very challenging to do that. And we have developed this aquamarine prototype that uses a compressed gas chamber that then ejects water out of its body, opens folding wings, and then this flies out of the water. So it uses 57 bar CO2 canister and environmental water to eject it out. So it would come, dive in, fill itself up with water, and then eject the water out to jump out of the water as well. Now, of course, we can model the entire thing. We can use Sanseri Bernoulli to identify the thrust and the velocity of the water coming out. So, I mean, there is some math involved. So, you actually do need to study here. It's not quite useful to do these things. But once you do that, you can then estimate the impulse, total impulse created by that, and use that to estimate the trajectory as it moves through these different fluids. Now, this trajectory allows us to then evaluate, for example, the cost of energetic cost of transport to see how much energy it uses underwater in air and what's the best way of moving through different environments. Now this is one of the prototypes that we have here at the moment, which ejects itself out and opens the wings. So in outdoor tests, so this is in Croatia where we went in September, to do the first test, so it would fly, then fold the wings, dive into the water and inject itself out. Now, the contributions here is really on the principle level, so we have to have a creative insights on how to build such vehicles. We have to look at nature, we have to have the courage to think something else and think beyond commercial quadcopters that you can buy. In fact, quadcopters might not be the solution for this type of application, or some variation might be, but you really have to be creative about it. You also have to model it, you have to understand the physics, and you have to understand manufacturing, hardware development, software development, to then make this happen. So you need contributions on all different sides. It's really an interdisciplinary research area. Now the last theme that I want to mention today is how these type of vehicles could support architecture or the built environment. How could they interact with buildings, with infrastructure to support us and provide us a better quality of life? Now one of the things that is needed is of course inspection. But it's not just inspection, it's not just identifying what is broken or what is leaking, for example, but it's also about how to repair that and how to even construct the environment using these aerial agents. So what then if you have a flying robot that would fly and be able to deposit materials from flight and act like a flying 3D printer to build entire houses? Right, so this sounds like a bit like science fiction, but in fact there is a trend in construction to use 3D printing, so it uses big ground-based 3D printers to build houses, and this is really good because it allows for the creation of novel building geometries which can be much more material efficient, and this is very important for the construction industry. So our approach here is to look at these autonomous repair and construction methods using a flying vehicle that would deposit materials. So this is the first test that we've seen two or three years ago, where we would fly and deposit polyurethane foam to build up layers of materials. Now I think we can maybe demonstrate one of the robots that we have here that can... Where is the pilot? Sorry. Oh, you're just... So we have here one commercially available quadcopter that we put together ourselves. It has a vision system, but it's remote controlled without much work on the stabilization. Precisely hovering. So in fact, to do this type of precision already needs an external camera system to make it hover this precisely. The other option is to have a vision system on board and have the relative positioning based on the vision what it sees. And that's one way forward which we are taking as well. The other way, however, is to look at ways how we can stabilize the ocean, because there might be wind and we might not be able to stabilize it very precisely. Now for this we have developed this stabilization methods that would then be able to 3D print very precisely, for example, these shelter structures where swarms would come and deposit these materials very precisely to build up larger structures. So the idea is then to have these vehicles that have a delta arm on them to stabilize the flight. So we have one here, you can have a look at it afterwards, but basically you have the agent and you would have this delta arm which can then stabilize, and even though there might be perturbation because of wind or anything like that, then the delta arm could stabilize and still provide very precise the position. So we have a precision of about a few centimeters without that, and one order of magnitude better with the delta arm. And one application that we showed there is in pipeline repairs. For example, you have a pipeline, gas pipeline that's leaking, and we have a vehicle that can go there and repair and deposit materials very precisely to do that. And this is what we demonstrated last year in Dubai for the Drones for Good challenge. In fact, we are going in about 2 weeks again to Dubai for this year's finals, where we are again in the finals. So we're looking forward to that. All that's completely connected from this. Okay, so why is it important? So it is important, for example, for heritage protection to look into ways how heritage buildings could be inspected and actually be maintained much better than they have been in the past. We are also testing them in the nuclear fusion reactors, as we have done in the coolant nuclear fusion reactor, to look at ways how we can inspect those beryllium tiles using these perching vehicles. Now the question then is, how do we make this a reality? And I think one important thing is to have this drone society to really make a platform for you all to come in with your ideas and with your enthusiasm and energy to work on these projects and have ideas and manifest these ideas. So I think that's one very important part. What we also need to recognize is there is a huge opportunity on the market of those technologies. In fact, if you look at UAV startups, they have a growth rate of more than 100%. There are also some very big failures in the drone startups, and in fact, it's not easy at all to get there. It's already very crowded. But there is the possibility and there is a huge need, and the need is organic. It's not a makeup, it's not a hype. There is a hype as well, there's a lot of talking about it, but there is more need than today is available, so it will grow organically. It is usually very good for areas where the people that you send it look like that. In fact, it's never a good sign to look like that. So because it's strange, it's dangerous, costly, you have to shut down the whole city as well. They can also help in urban resilience and recovery, disaster response, very quickly to provide the help to the people that need the help, instead of having to go there, which takes days often. And also, they could be supporting sustainable urban ecosystem that they could detect, for example, pollution or maintain the green infrastructure in our future cities. You've seen maybe Mexico City has created those green gardens on the highways, and they also need to be maintained. So this as well could be one of these type of approaches. So now if you get this right, if you get the ethics right of our approaches and you think of an ethical way how to augment our world, our planet, then we create this robotic planet which is also a human planet and really this smart planet that we all look for. So thank you for your attention.